Thanks to you, everyone, for being here early in the morning. We very much appreciate it. It's really hard to believe that it's been 1 year since we last gathered here, just days before the Dodd-Frank Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act was signed into law. I'm sure all of you will agree, because you're on the front lines, that this has been a very, very busy year. The financial crisis of 08 exposed real flaws in the financial regulatory systems both at home and abroad. Dodd-Frank is the U.S. framework looking to fix those flaws. While Dodd-Frank is the law, by design, it is a framework. It leaves room for interpretation. It provides guidance for rulemaking. That's what the regulators have been working on for the past year. SIFMA supports many of the changes proposed in Dodd-Frank. We have devoted enormous resources to the task of working with regulators through the public notice and comment period. To date, SIFMA alone has filed over 100 comment letters. It's our attempt to help inform the process and provide information needed by the regulators so that they can create regulations that work. We're also working seamlessly in coordination with other trade associations, divvying up assignments based on expertise. We all want to see increased coordination and comprehensive cost-benefit analysis to ensure the new rules as proposed actually help make our financial system safer and more secure and provide the infrastructure to move our still fragile economy forward. Yesterday, SIFMA's Economic Advisory Roundtable, this is the economists from basically all the major firms, released its semi-annual economic outlook for the second half of 2011 and the first half of 2012. Beyond general predictions about economic growth, jobs, interest rate, and monetary policy, we asked our roundtable to assess the economic impact through credit availability and cost of Dodd-Frank. In the end, respondents were generally negative about the impact Dodd-Frank could have on economic growth, availability of credit, and cost of credit to households and businesses over the next 18 months. Over 75% of survey respondents expected a negative impact on credit availability, and nearly 60% expected a negative impact on the cost of credit for households. The forecast for impact on the business sector was only slightly less negative, with 65% and 53% predicting a negative impact on availability of credit and cost of credit, respectively. SIFMA is not alone in our call for greater coordination and studies on the cost-benefit analysis of these rules on the economy. Federal Reserve Chairman Bernanke states that while everyone involved wants a system that is coherent and consistent with banks performing their vital social functions in terms of extending credit, he also notes that nobody has looked at all of the detail. We need to study the collective impact of all new regulations in the works before layering on even more requirements. It's critical that we all understand the impact of Dodd-Frank and the numerous other initiatives already undertaken to make our financial system safer by reducing risk. And I'll just list a few of the things that have happened here over the last year and a half. Balance sheets have improved, and accounting standards are far more transparent. Since the end of 07, U.S. financial firms have raised over $300 billion of common equity while repaying taxpayers for their TARP investments early and with a $12 billion profit. The largest U.S. banks have reduced their average leverage ratio from 16 to 1 to 11 to 1, and increased loan loss reserves by about 200%. All off-balance sheet activities have been reduced dramatically. All large U.S. financial institutions are now subject to Federal Reserve supervision and capital requirements. Many have already undergone on stress tests with both the Treasury and the Fed. Banks pay more into the FDIC insurance fund. As we all know, derivative markets are in the process of being transformed with more supervision. All originators of mortgages and other consumer products are now subject to the same rules and federal supervision. Dodd-Frank requires risk retention of more robust disclosure for all asset-backed securitizations. And banks are prohibited from engaging in certain types of proprietary trading as defined by the Volcker Rule. With these changes already in place, we're now facing the rules coming under the Dodd-Frank Act and possibly even higher capital requirements over Basel III standards with proposed surcharges for systemically important banks. You've all heard how big Dodd-Frank mandate is. 235 rulemakings, already generating 41 reports, 71 studies offered by 11 different federal agencies and bureaus. Much work has already been done. As of July 1, we've finalized 38 new rules, but we still have a long road ahead of us. 26 deadlines have been missed. That, by the way, is not a bad thing. That says to me that they're focused on getting it right. So don't view a missed deadline as a bad thing. That's probably a good thing. We have 215 rules yet to be proposed. 122 rulemaking deadlines come due in the third quarter of 2011. So we have this huge, huge funnel we're going through here. That's more than a quarter of all of the rulemakings, which need to be done in the next, really, quarter or two. All of this is taking place, obviously, in the midst of unstable economic environment, both here in the United States and in the EU. So regulators are faced with a daunting task of implementing Dodd-Frank. There are a lot of balls in the air, and we're not as targeted as we should be. To complicate matters, multiple regulators have joint jurisdiction over the same markets and products. We are concerned coordination across regulations, jurisdictions, and geographical boundaries is just not happening at a level it should. And I'm sure we'll talk about that in these panels here today. What will happen if we lack the coordination and the time to assess the totality of regulatory burdens? We think at SIFMA that we'll greatly decrease the odds that we'll do this correctly. There's a danger of the rules not working together. We risk impeding the flow of capital and credit, which in turn would undermine both economic growth and job creation. This would impact not just the financial markets, not just global corporations, but would have a profound impact on the lives of ordinary citizens. Make no mistake, we're not here to say, don't do anything. We support regulatory reform and Dodd-Frank because it is the law of the land, and we'll follow it. But we do believe that as new regulations are created, they must be balanced and consistent. And that requires taking a little bit more time to do a study or a review in order to get the rules right, then that's what they should do. Take more time. Now, what do we mean by balanced? These are measures designed to increase safety, not hinder the market's ability to be a source of asset and credit. It's important to consider whether rules designed to reduce systemic risk may pose a greater threat to our economy by strangling credit. But no one is looking at that threat. Here's an example of the balance needed in meeting Dodd-Frank. We want to uphold the spirit of Dodd-Frank, but need to do so with an understanding of current market conditions and taking these considerations into the overall impact of all of the regulations. In fact, Dodd-Frank created a specific new entity to do just that, the Financial Stability Oversight Council, or FSOC. The FSOC is chaired by the Treasury Secretary. It has all of the regulatory agencies as members. Their mandate is to monitor all domestic and international regulatory proposals that impact U.S. competitiveness. That's a pretty broad responsibility, and we believe it's an important responsibility that they must exercise. We urge the FSOC to ensure consistent implementation of regulations both domestically and internationally. Unfortunately for the FSOC, there are a lot of moving parts. This is a very tough job. While they are trying to implement standards for both bank and non-bank systemically important financial institutions, these are SIFIs, they are also working simultaneously with the Financial Stability Board, called the FSB, and the Basel Committee on Standards, the BIS. We have to have rules from U.S. regulators in sync with the rest of the world, including what's coming out of the EU and Asia, as well as the FSB, the BIS, and its Basel Committee. We cannot unilaterally impose restrictions on institutions in the U.S. markets that do not apply in other major financial markets around the world, creating unnecessary barriers to market entry and putting U.S. financial markets and the companies and individuals who rely on their depth and liquidity at a disadvantage. We cannot risk the financial competitiveness of U.S. markets, nor can we risk the competitiveness of global markets. Perhaps the single most compelling issue threatening U.S. competitiveness is international capital and liquidity requirements and the possible capital surcharge for globally systemically important or institutions. We call these GSIBs, so globally systemically important banks. Probably about 25 to 50 of these institutions around the world. A vital piece of that issue is determining who are these GSIBs. And that single question can't be answered without first answering a whole series of related questions. Who decides whether a firm should be on the list? Is it a global decision? Should countries without GSIBs have a say in the process? What are the consequences of being a GSIB? How do you know when you are approaching becoming a GSIB? How can you manage your business to avoid such a designation, which I'm sure many of you in this room would like to avoid? So there's many, many questions around GSIBs. There's many, many questions around, once you're designated, is there a right of appeal? Is there a review? Will that list be public? And if so, how is it made public? By whom and when? These are material decisions. This is one area where we need to recognize that while we want to implement all the Dodd-Frank regulatory mandates, some regulations need the time it takes to see the effect of other regulations. And we strongly believe that any decision on a special capital surcharge for these GSIBs really awaits the finalization of other interrelated standards. We've been working with our global affiliate, which is called the GFMA, Global Financial Markets Association, to voice the industry's position on policies like capital requirements emanating from the Financial Stability Board and from the G20. We all believe harmonization of the standards is a laudable goal. We like their ideas around peer reviews so that we have consistent activities by regulators on a global basis. And we will work tirelessly with them to make sure that any rules on capital and liquidity make sense and are in sync with the Dodd-Frank requirements. We must make sure that the Dodd-Frank regulations balance the longstanding consequences with their short-term objectives, that they're consistent and implemented at the right time and in coordination with global initiatives. During the next year, SIFMA will continue providing information and analysis to regulators as they move forward, and we will highlight the need for enhanced coordination and cost-benefit analysis to ensure our financial regulatory system is safe and strong and will be equipped to fuel economic growth and job creation as we move forward. Thank you very much.